Studying rock and roll's history, one would be remiss if they didn't highlight the contributions of Sister Rosetta Tharpe. With thumping rhythms and heavy distortion, the music maven invented her own style of playing the guitar that the world had never seen. Rolling Stone News sat down with artist Yola, who plays Sister Rosetta Tharpe in the new Baz Luhrmann-directed film, Elvis. Yola gave Sister Rosetta Tharpe her flowers and explained the power of Tharpe's influence on her artistry.
For those who don't know, here's a little history lesson. I'm lucky. I grew up amongst music nerds and record collectors and just everyone was so nerdy about music, and I was, so I just absorbed everything. So I was a fan of Sister Rosetta Tharpe, and the things that really struck me was this idea of guitar distortion. So, you have a guitar, plug it into an amp, you turn it on, it rings nice and clear, you hear the sound of the guitar, and then you can start playing with all the knobs and make it sound a certain way. She's like, I can distort this whole thing so it starts breaking up and doing almost the thing it's not supposed to do in an odd way. And so she was the first person to do that to the point that it was profoundly heavy. That's one of the archetypal central aesthetics to rock and roll. Then add to that her time spent in the blues circuit. She took all of that blues bending and her style, coming from the church, she's given that pace, that energy. So she's taking blues bends and she's giving it this church-related pace and building up this energy to the point where it's rocking the shred, this first shred. She is that first person to innovate that sound, that energy, and the drivingness that is rock and roll. Elvis runs home from school when he's a kid to listen to her on the radio. He'll do anything to get home to listen to her. And as he grows up, he's just absorbing all of that. Same with Little Richard, same with B.B. King. All these people, they were the youngest. She was the generation older. So she's already been doing this for, 10, 15 years before, they've had any introduction to the idea of it. And so that's something that, for me, I'm trying to redress that imbalance of credit and of knowledge just in the general populace. I think we have to give her flowers and give Black America their flowers for being the home of another foundational genre of American and contemporary music. Speaking of giving Black America their flowers, and in this particular case, Black women their flowers, that idea of recognition for Black women specifically, I think people, they speak of musical genius, but they find it hard to conflate the idea of femininity and genius. The number of times you'll read an article with someone who has written some lovely songs, but they involve playing the chords C, D, and G, and I can tell you right now, it's easy to play those chords, people, okay? Or they're singing a song and it's a beautifully written song. Fair dues. But it doesn't quite equate to genius, but it's very easily bandied around in the proximity of testosterone. And I think that's so, add then being an ethnic minority to that dynamic, in this case, Black, this whole process of giving Black women their flowers is something that we are profoundly late on. I think it's 2016 or 2017 that Sister Rosetta Tharpe was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. So if I had invented a genre, I'd be pissed. If I was like, hey, I just invented a whole gosh darn genre, I give you this gargantuan gift, more valuable than a Fabergé egg, and then I discover Little Richard and I give you that gift, and he influences people like Prince and Michael Jackson. They are operating in the era of Parliament Funkadelic, and then hip hop samples from that era, people like Childish Gambino, and are influenced by that generation. And the lineage just from her is, and that's just one line I can think of. I can think of many, many, many. We take her out of history, there's a gaping chasm that is left. So the idea of us having a somehow equal level of gratitude for those gifts, we're not even close. We're not even close. And cross-genre, you see this replicated. People finding it hard to call people geniuses. I remember watching on Instagram people talking about Missy Elliott, and they're just about getting there. I'm like, she's clearly a genius. Can we just say the word in words and like use the G word? It's time. Like, if you're going to use it in so fluidly in other spaces, this definitely applies. And so, yeah, like, it doesn't matter what genre you're in. Like, this is something that we need to start doing. We need to broadly be able to start talking about women as geniuses, and especially Black women, because we're doing the most. So when it comes to this movie, I feel like Black women are represented in a way that feels foundational to the story. It's a movie about Elvis. So we're going to get a story about Elvis. But we've always had this story out of context. We've always had this story as if he was hewn, not born. Black women play this foundational role in the making of Elvis. From Sister Rosetta Tharpe, who I play, her creating of a genre that he grows up on and that inspires him, to Big Mama Thornton, who sings a very profoundly raunchy horn dog. It's like horn dog, hound dog, horn dog, hound dog, same thing. Let's not forget Mahalia Jackson, of all people, goodness gracious. We're getting this, like, the most heartfelt, authentic portrayals of Black and female innovation and creativity in this movie. And it's creating the world in which Elvis really doesn't want to have to leave. And you're like, yeah, I get it. It looks lit. The number of times I watch a movie and I'm like, you've done us dirty as Black women, is like a lot. And I didn't get that feeling one time. And that, my friends, is a victory. You know, right there. Not only that, but we're actually a foundational reason. We're the raison d'etre. We're the source. We're the alpha and the omega of this situation. Great, of which we spring forth this little musical baby. We get this treatment that is like just essential, and, you know, providing this really essential context to the story. And even though it's a story about Elvis and it's not about us to a degree, it's something that every story that isn't about us needs. Context. So as to how Sister Rosetta Tharpe, Mahalia Jackson, and Big Mama Thornton make themselves known in my work, I have a song called Diamond Studded Shoes, and like, I rock out on guitar on that. And I feel like if I didn't have exposure to Sister Rosetta and her guitar stylings, I don't feel like I would have felt that instant kinship and ownership of guitar playing, because I was told like a gazillion times that a Black woman had no right playing guitar. I was even told by a record company, A&R, that no one wanted to hear a Black woman sing rock and roll. And I was like, well, that's weird, because a Black woman invented it. So babes, like, I was lucky that I had exposure to these artists early to be able to grasp these things and make them feel like a home for me, you know, because I had, you know, the ancestors lighting the way. And, you know, the gravel in my voice, like Mahalia and especially Big Mama Thornton, like, she's like, you ain't nothing but a, you know, she's like in there. And when I got to the top of my body, there's gravel, guys. So I was singing like Aaliyah, and I didn't sound like her. Okay, I could get closer to Mary J. She's got some gravel, but Brandy, Aaliyah, not even close, boo. But I grew up in that era and I was like, I sound different. Why am I different? And that's really what it was. I've got like, I was made different. I'm of a model that maybe is a little old school, but hey, it's who I am. And these women help light the way. So that would feel normal as opposed to me being some kind of weird pariah.